That was fantastic. And speaking of brilliant stories, we do have to congratulate the winners in the other age divisions. Kaya Lichtleitner of Germany winning the juniors and Tanner Hurley of the USA winning in seniors. Congratulations to those. And Reagan there, who we saw in the video, second place, not a bad finish.
Not too bad at all, absolutely. And that means that every other game has been concluded. That means all that's left is the Masters Finals. We're going to throw up the brackets to see how both players have got there. As you can see, Michael Pramer on the right side of the screen, he was able to overcome Grafton Roll's Greninja deck, and then we just seen him overcome Philip to make it to the final. And then on Jacob Lesage's side, he was able to defeat a Volcanion deck and also Tord Reklev in a mirror match.
And fantastic play from both of these players, both playing this Yveltal Garbodor deck, both playing very, very similar decks, and both doing fantastically well to get here. Now, they've both had to win the mirror match in top four, and I'm going to go ahead and make an assumption that they've won a few mirror matches this weekend. Now, they both say they've teched for the mirror match. They both feel very confident playing the mirror match, but of course, there's only going to be one winner. Is it going to be Jacob Lesage? Now, he's come here all the way from Canada. He has, as you can see there, he's the Canadian national champion. He got the top eight. He did fantastically well there, and he's won some difficult games to get here, but of course, Michael Pramawat, he's pretty good as well, you know, second place at Worlds.
Yeah, and you can see Jacob there, he's looking very relaxed. He's very used to being in these sorts of situations. He's with a good pal, Michael Pramawat, who is also used to being in these situations. Oftentimes, he finds himself in the finals of all big tournaments. You're going to see in a very impressive CV here. Really, these two players are going to have to outplay each other because there's very few differences between their deck lists. It's really just three or four cards that both players have that's really going to be the difference at the end of the day here.
It really is. And of course, Michael Pramawat, runner-up at Worlds, runners-up at Nationals. Now we've got these international championships. Could this be the one that Pramawat gets to win, or is he going to add another impressive second place to his resume? Now we've seen the handshake. We are off double Trubbish start, and it looks like Jacob is going to be starting us off here. And we start with trainer's mail.
Yeah, it's not a bad kickoff. He doesn't really have any useful draw cards. He can only just find himself a Fighting Fury Belt. We can see both players' prize cards here. Nothing too dangerous. One counts of a couple of things. Jacob does have a few VS Seekers. Also the Shaman EX. These are good things to take off prize cards as long as he can get a good start here.
Well, the one prize that does stand out to me, that Pokémon Center Lady that Pram has got in his prizes, it's a card that Jacob doesn't play. It heals 60 damage. It's actually very important. But what's more important is, it looks like Jacob just attached a Fighting Fury Belt and passed there.
That is far from ideal. There's been a few games, even with Pramwell earlier on throughout the days, he's been able to donk things like Froakies. And if he gets something like a Floatstone, Max Elixir Start, and also Double Colors Energy, we could have a very rapid game one here.
We could indeed. Now, when we say donk, we refer to knocking out your opponent's only Pokemon on your first turn of the game, winning when your opponent doesn't really get much of a shout. Now, he will need either two energy and a Fighting Fury Belt, or he will need three energy, and he's going to need a Floatstone to get that Trubbish out of the active. Now, he's played two Max Elixirs. Let him look at the top six cards of his deck, attach a basic energy to a benched basic Pokemon. First one, he hit an energy, popped it on the Yveltal. Second one, he didn't, so he still needs that double colorless Floatstone combination in order to go ahead and get the win here.
Well, bear in mind that there is the Fighting Fury Belt on the Trubbish, so it's going to be a little bit more difficult for Michael. Regardless, he does find that second Dark Energy to attach, even if he's not able to, you know, deal with the Trubbish this turn, which it looks unlikely at this point. He still got off to a great start. Two Dark Energy on the main attacker, where Jacob really has not drawn much.
But he didn't play a supporter there, did he?
Nope.
So both players have gone for their first turn. They haven't actually played a supporter. Oh, and Jacob passes again, and there might be a Fighting Fury Belt on that Trubbish. He is not going to last forever. He's got 110 HP, so now a double colorless Fighting Fury Belt will do 110, and that will give him the KO against that Trubbish, but it's still quite a bit to ask for. Double colorless, Fighting Fury Belt, Floatstone. I'd expect Michael here to use an Ultra Ball, search for a Shaman, draw some more cards, and really try and get going, because all he needs to draw is those three cards and he will have the win here. And this time I've looked at the Fighting Fury Belt and I mean it.
Absolutely. So we saw a very intelligent play from Michael. He was holding on to two ends and a VS Seeker last turn. He noticed that Jacob simply played the Fighting Fury Belt and passed, so he thought you know what, my start was good enough, there's no need for me to play a supporter, I can wait. It turns out his top deck happened to be Professor Sycamore, so now is when he goes on the aggressive turn, and it looks likely that he might be able to get the knockout here. He does have a few more cards he can draw. We can see he's currently going for the Ultra Ball, thinning out his deck. I'm not sure if there's already a Shaymin EX in his hand. It does look like he's happy enough to go for Garbodor, so that's likely going to be the case here.
Indeed, and he may well even just be grabbing that Garbodor to discard it with Professor Sycamore. Just one fewer card in his deck means more chance of drawing what he wants. He could evolve it up, but I'd expect him to want to play Shaymin here. Oh, he does put
well,
it right up.
Without the tool yet, the Garbodoxin isn't too big of a worry, so we are just going to see the evolution, a couple of bench Pokemon, followed up by another Max Elixir here, so three energy on this Yveltal EX.
But it does mean that now he's going to have to be... He can still get a Float Stone, but he's got to get the Float Stone after playing a Shaymin. And he does play one Escape Rope. He can use that to get it out the active. And he's already planning to play the Shaymin. That's what he was doing. He knew he could empty his hand out and then play the Shaymin. And it looks like he's got it. Double colorless Float Stone. Five energy, turn two of Yveltal. That is tough to deal with, even if you don't have a bad start.
Well, I mean, I don't even know how to react to this. Jacob, he's taken it very well. He's still smiling. He's just going to accept that that's one way to win a game of Pokemon, unfortunately. We have seen on stream a few times where players have not been able to draw optimally. Pram there, he's been able to get a very crazy start with five energy on a Yveltal EX by turn two. Not bad by anyone's standards. Even better when it means you're taking out the only Pokemon in the game to take game one here.
And that is just a wonderful, wonderful start from Michael Pramawat there, just seeing what he needed to do. And I loved his point about the first turn, when he could have played the end, but he didn't need to play the end. N puts both players' cards back into their deck. They shuffle up, draw a number of prize cards, a number of cards equal to their remaining prizes. So six each turn one. But of course, Michael didn't need to do that. He knew that Jacob didn't have many cards, and it worked out beautifully. Had he given Jacob a new hand, maybe he bented another Pokemon, we'd probably still going on with the game. It's those subtle little plays that make the difference between a good player and a great player like Michael, who's in this final here, and I'd be willing to bet he's been pulling off little tricks like that for the past 3 days, because let's not forget, they're on day three of competition here.
Absolutely, yeah. They've ground through not only the top eight today, but also 14 rounds previously with very, very respectable records. It's a really bizarre situation that both players find themselves in because that game almost didn't count in terms of that we didn't really see any play style from either player. Well, we didn't see any tricks, any sort of preferences where they're trying to do things in a certain way. That they've really gained no information about each other's play style. Now, we know at this stage in the tournament that both players will know the entire lists of their opponents, so they know exactly what could come out of the opponent's deck and what they could be trying to do in terms of a mirror match. However, we didn't really see the play style of either player, so it's almost like a redo. It's just this time Pram has one up.
He is, and I am interested to know, and I don't know the answer to this question, but of course both of their games were streamed individually, so they may well have actually had a chance to watch each other's top four games, which were somewhat improbably both Yveltal mirror matches. So they've actually both seen each other play this matchup before. One huge thing about winning game one, it means if there is a game three, Michael's going to be going first. And going first in the Pokemon trading card game is absolutely huge. And Michael's going to get the opportunity to do that.
Absolutely. It's a pretty big deal. We do see that Pram has been able to set up here. Jacob, it looks like he has had a mulligan. Looking at the prize cam real quick from Michael's end, it looks like two of his Garbodors are prized. So that might mean that one interesting interaction in this matchup is going to be when the Garbodor comes into play. And if Jacob's going to be the one accessing his Garbodor first, he'll be the one in control of this. Knowing when to turn off the Fright Knight Yveltal's ability is sometimes a big difference here, because it means that Fighting Fury Belt comes online, and it also means that Float Stone's active.
And we've seen that time and time again. In fact, we saw it in Jacob's last game, where turning off that Garbodor, or in fact discarding the Garbodor from a parallel city, really changed the game. Now, we do see both Trubbish's prized by Jacob and both Garbodor's prized by Pram. So let's just say we are not... Oh, that's a little bit of an insult. Both Garbodor's prized, and he starts with a Trubbish,
yeah,
which we know he can't evolve.
It's pretty sad stuff here. Regardless, Jacob is going to lead with the Fighting Fury Belt. Looks like he has got an Ultra Ball, which he's going to play in his hand. I did also see a Professor Sycamore in there, so... Already, Jacob's had a much better start. You can see by the prize cam, he does have a few awkward prizes, let alone the Trubbishes. There's also one double colorless energy and two darks in there, so pretty awkward stuff for Jacob's end.
It is, but unfortunately these things happen. We've seen some awkward prizes, you know, seeing two Frogadier prized in a Game 3 when you're playing Greninja from Grafton Roll earlier was, shall we say, less than ideal. But Jacob's had a very good start here. He's got the Yveltal, who is a very good attacker. Now, there's different situations. Sometimes you want the Fright Knight Yveltal, sometimes you want the EX, but he's got an attacker. He's got the Fighting Fury Bout. He's got an energy, and he seems content to pass there. Michael might be able to get an attack off this turn, but he's not going to be getting a KO, and he needs a lot to get the attack off. He needs a Float Stone or Escape Rope to get the Trubbish out of the active. He needs an attacker, and he has no one energy attacker. So he's going to need at least a manual energy attachment and a Max Elixir, as well as a way to get the Trubbish out of the active, and this is quite an important one here, something with which to attack.
Yeah, that does help out. Jacob almost getting a little bit punished for his almost greedy Shaman EX there, because it looked like he drew into a couple of Max Elixir, and he was hoping to use the Professor Sycamore later on in his turn, but now that seems like a couple of precious resources he could do with, so instead he's not going to play the Professor Sycamore, has to pass it over to Michael, who then puts down a Shaman EX to draw no cards, follows up with a Professor Sycamore, and finally he finds himself a couple of Yveltal EXs in which he's able to attach to, and now we see the second setup from Shaman here.
He's drawing a lot of cards, but that Sycamore was quite painful for Michael there. He had to lose a double colorless energy, and he had to lose a Versus Seeker, and they are, at least by these lists, they are irrecoverable cards, which are always incredibly useful. You can recover a double colorless with special charge, but Michael isn't playing one. Now we do, ooh, it looked like a retreat there. He does retreat into the second Trubbish. He's got a Float Stone on the bench Trubbish. Of course, it's not going to be evolving yet, but if at any point he draws into that Garbodor, he is then going to be able to evolve and turn off that Fright Knight ability. And like we've said, the interaction there is very useful. Now, Jacob is going to want a second Yveltal EX here.
Yeah, absolutely. All he could do was attach the double colorless energy and opt to go for the Evil Ball, it looks like, to deal with that Trubbish. Pram does promote his Float Stone to Trubbish, and it's a big turn from him. We do see an Enhanced Hammer in combination with a Team Flare Grunt here to pretty much set that Yveltal EX back almost two turns of attachment.
I mean, there's no attachment there at all. And the thing is, these Yveltal decks, like we said, they rely on a combination of double colorless and Max Elixir. And you need to play both of them in tandem to have the requisite energy to attack. Well, you can't play a Max Elixir when you don't have a bench Pokemon, or at least one that you really want to get the energy on.
Absolutely. So it looked like Pram was struggling to get a real good supporter, or at least he was struggling to get energy. So he used the Team Flare Grunt as a stalling option. Jacob only able to attach the double colorless energy. Now Pram does find himself a Max Elixir, which he can play. So he could be the one being aggressive here and starting to target down the Yveltal EX on Jacob's end.
And sooner or later, now Jacob did get that little prize off of Trubbish. That was really, really good. Now, if he could repeat that trick, he's KO'd two Trubbishes. He really needs to be going after the EXs. And up comes Michael Pramawat here, and he's going to be doing just 100 damage. Four combined energy is 80, plus the 20 base is 100. And that means that Yveltal will be KO'd next turn. So if there is a supporter there that Jacob can play, he needs to play it. It's a Team Flare Grunt only, so I don't think he has any supporter there at all. I don't think he has a Sycamore. He has a Team Flare Grunt, well, which he got out of the discard pile using a Versus Seeker. So he does get a Max Elixir, and he plays it onto the Shaman. He's recognizing here that actually, I do need to do something, and he might... Now, I can't even use a Sky Return here, because then he'd have no bench Pokemon, and an Yveltal about to be KO'd. So he uses the Max Elixir, but really he's just putting the energy on the Shaman. There's nothing he can really do much here. So Michael could be getting a KO here. Jacob has no real backup attacker. And if Michael does get a KO, and he only needs a double colorless energy to do so, a single energy won't do because of the Fighting Fury Bout, then at that stage, Jacob's going to be left with just a Shaman with a single energy on, and that's not going to do him much good as this game wears on.
Absolutely. I think that Max Elixir from Jacob was simply so that if he is to draw out of this, he then has essentially a free retreat option from the Shaman EX, so he can commit his manual attachments elsewhere. Over to Pram, he was debating putting the Float Stone onto the active Yveltal EX. Instead, he's going to opt to put that on the Shaman on his bench, and he's going to follow up with N. This could potentially give Jacob a way back into this game, because he wasn't drawing much here. However, it's what Pram has to do, because he wants to keep the aggression going. That Yveltal EX, if otherwise Michael would maybe just have passed, and then the Yveltal EX does does become a threat. So he has to play the end here. He's digging pretty hard for this double colorless energy.
Now playing the end, like you said, it gives both players a new hand. And there is a lot of skill here in deciding when to play the end. But here's the thing. Sooner or later, your opponent will draw something.
Okay.
And there we go. This is kind of the things that Michael was looking for. He needed to draw some things. He drew enough to get the KO. He didn't get the double colorless, but he got the basic and the Fury Bout. That was enough to get the KO. And if he'd have passed, and then Jacob would have top decked a Professor Sycamore, he would have really regretted that. That was the perfect time to play an end. And just showing, again, the high-level play we're seeing here in the final.
Yeah, absolutely. And if we switch over to the prize cam very quickly, we can see that both Garbodors were taken. Michael has been able to keep one of his Trubbishes around with the Floatstone, so that's going to be an option for him from this turn onwards. It's still Jacob's, however. He is going to attach a Fighting Fury Belt to the active Shaymin EX, and he's going to play the Professor Sycamore now. Looks like he didn't get too many options. I think he is considering maybe benching a Pokemon. He hasn't done any attachments for turn yet, so he's going to look to start powering up some of his bench Pokemon more likely here. He does have the option for Sky Return, but I'm not sure what it really provides him. I think he sort of needs to start powering up some attackers here.
I agree with you entirely there, Joe. I don't think you can use Sky Return. It's too much investment for too little reward. He needs a double colorless, he needs a max elixir, and then he needs to be attacking. Now, if he could, and it's quite a lot to ask for here, but maybe get a... it doesn't look like he's got much. I was hoping maybe a Y-Cyclone, able to put the double colorless onto another Yveltal EX on the bench, really start setting him up for some KOs later. All he's done is passed with a Fright Knight in the active, and it doesn't, again, even after the end, he's not got enough to keep up with the attackers.
Yeah, that's really a bit of a problem. However, with that retreat of the Shaymin EX, he is going to at least force Pram into a bit of an awkward spot, maybe force a Lysander out of him rather than anything else, because currently the Fright Knight in the active will be able to take any hit that the Yveltal EX is currently able to do. Looks like Pram was happy enough simply to attach the benched Yveltal EX and simply an attack with Evil Ball here, obviously taking off that little one damage because of the Fright Knight ability.
Yeah, that Fighting Fury about doesn't do much when there's a Fright Knight in the active, although I suppose it does make him look just that little bit prettier. Michael here, he's working on his board state. Knocking out that Fright Knight isn't terribly important. He's taken two prizes. Two EXKOs will get him the win. Taking a seventh prize doesn't get him much closer to winning, means he can be end down to a single card hand, and of course, it means he's just putting more and more energy onto a Pokemon that's not really KOing anything of note. Better to just build up your board and just wait a little while. I like what Michael's doing here. Now, he is giving Jacob a bit of time to get back in the game, but Michael's starting with a one prize lead. He's starting with a better ball state. So if we give both players an even amount of time to set up, Michael's still in the driver's seat.
Absolutely, and you can see it on Jacob's face that he's sort of battling with himself. Where do I put this energy? Do I commit it to my Yveltal EX? It sort of feels like if Michael Sims just has the Lysander, then maybe I'm in a really bad spot, but I sort of have to gamble at this point. I'm already a little bit behind. I need to catch up. I need to just hope that Michael doesn't have the Lysander on this turn. He may even be hoping that Michael continues to attack the Fright Knight that's currently in the active, almost do him a favor in many ways by knocking it out instead. Now that Pram has put the Garbodor down into play, the Fighting Fury Belt will work, so simply an Evil Ball will finish off this active Yveltal. We do see the double colorless energy get attached to the Yveltal EX. We do have to remember that both players are playing Enhanced Hammers. This is oftentimes a big card in this matchup.
It really is. Now, we've already seen Michael, I believe, play one this game. Both players are playing two. So those double colorless energies are not safe by any stretch of the imagination. So you've got to be really careful, because if you play a double colorless energy down and your opponent then goes and plays an Enhanced Hammer to discard it, it's as if you didn't attach an energy the previous turn, and as if you forgot to put a double colorless in your deck in the first place, it doesn't get you any closer to winning. So most of the good players here, and these players will have this in mind, you only attach a double colorless energy when you have to, when you're taking a KO, or when you need an attachment and you just don't have basic energy to attach. They're the two times you do it. It's not ideal, but it's got to be done. Speaking of got to be done, Pram's playing a Sycamore.
Exactly. That's exactly the case why he did commit the double colorless energy to the bench Yveltal EX. We can see he then finds himself a Fighting Fury Belt, which is pretty good as well. So his end of the board looks very strong. He chose to play an Ultra Ball to find another Yveltal EX. He seemed pretty content to get the full board ready to go now that two already are pretty much set up, and it's really in Jacob's end to see what he can do to answer already two Yveltal EXs and potentially even a third in the coming turns.
And that is the problem here. It's not just that Michael's two prizes up, although he is, and I'm sure he's delighted about this. It's the fact that he's got two of Elderly X's, both with Fury Bouts. Well, now one's got two energy, one's got one, because Jacob's using that enhanced hammer we spoke about. And he's even got a third on the bench just to be like, you know, I'm here if you need me. Jacob's got free energy on one of Elderly X. Now, what he's probably going to do is what I assume he wanted to do last turn. Y Cyclone for 90 damage, move the double colorless to the bench. But he's now playing the kind of slower control game, which is really what you want to do if you're ahead in prizes. When you're behind in prizes, you really need to take a big KO somewhere. And Jay is not in a position to do it. Annoyingly for Jacob, Michael is in a much better position to be getting the first Yveltal KO. This is not where he wants to be.
Although that enhanced hammer has almost flipped the board state. Michael was ahead on energy attachments, and after the enhanced hammer plus an attachment of a double colorless of his own, Jacob now seems to be in a bit of a better spot. He also has some max elixir that it looks like he's drawn into, so he could further increase his energy advantage on Michael. Right now he's not got the prize advantage, but oftentimes that's not what this matchup comes down to. It's going to be a race of sorts, but as long as you can deal with the Yveltals, it's really whoever has the last Yveltal standing which is going to end up deciding the game.
And here comes that max elixir. We know he's got the energy there. So actually, you're right, the board has completely flipped. Right as I'm starting to say how Michael's got a better board state, Jacob drops down the double colorless energy, plays the max elixir, makes me look silly, but also makes it a more competitive game, so I am willing to forgive him for that. Now, he's still not threatening a KO here. One option, now, I like the Y-Cyclone play here. The problem is, Y-Cyclone, you can't leave five energy on an Yveltal. That is begging for your opponent to Lysander the Yveltal and KO it. If he maybe gets a third Yveltal out here and then attaches a double colorless energy through the use of Y-Cyclone to that, that could really set Jacob up to go toe-to-toe with Michael. As it is, I think he's in a good position, but he's going to have to be very, very careful. Board position is key, and I agree with you, Joe, that's what this matchup comes down to. But oftentimes, it also comes down to playing N, the great equalizer. And if Jacob plays an N, and Michael draws a Sycamore, and then goes ahead and sets up, that prize lead could become very important.
And we do see Jacob, he does have the Delinquent in hand. That might be why he's wanting to put the Parallel City in before Michael Pram has the option to do so. Of course, limiting his own bench to three means that Michael still has two Shamany X's on his side of the board. Those could be easy prizes later on in the game for Jacob. So a pretty cute play there. That's pretty smart in my opinion. He also chose to hold the Max Elixir and go for the Evil Ball. That way, Michael doesn't really have the easy option of just, oh, I'll Lysander the one that has more energy. That's a more threatening Pokemon. This way, both of the Yveltal EXs are equally threatening, so he sort of has to just charge through the active one this turn.
And it's an excellent point. I wanted to go with a Y-Cyclone, and from my experience, most of the players in that situation do want to go for a Y-Cyclone. But like you've said, you've got to think about the placement of the energy. The DCE does nothing on the Shaman, so let's just throw that right out the window. And you can't have five energy on an Yveltal. And he's limited his own bench to three. I think in an ideal world, Jacob here just gets that third Yveltal, gets them all set up, and then he's able to try and control the game with that. Fright Knight Yveltal is, like I said a moment ago, it's really good early game, spreads some damage around. It's very easily KO'd by an Yveltal EX. He really wants to make Michael KO two EXs to win the game here, not feed him a nice, easy one prize attacker that's not doing enough damage. So I think Jacob here, I think Fright Knight's out the window for him. I think it's EXs or bust.
Absolutely. Definitely, as you said, he sort of had to use his non-EX resource just to stall for time in the early turns when he didn't have much going for him. Pram, he lost a Trubbish early on, so pretty much we're going to see exclusively Yveltal EX versus Yveltal EX action here.
And it's going to come down to conservative use of Y-Cyclone and whoever can make the maths work. And it's a proper cat and mouse game. You want to put enough energy on to get the KO, but then you don't want to put enough energy on for them to get the KO. So then you're sitting there, and this will really test your mathematical skills, at least in terms of adding up 20 over and over again. Just trying to make sure I can do this much damage and take the KO next turn, but then he can't take the KO in the meantime. It's a very awkward thing to do, but I mean, by this stage in the tournament, they should be practiced.
Yeah, you definitely think so. Pram does opt to go for the escape rope here. This could cause Jacob into a bit of an awkward spot. At the very least, it would mean that it depends really what he wants to bring up here. If he chooses to bring up the other Yveltal EX, it's as if there's no difference in terms of what is going to get damaged. In terms of the board state, he could also opt for the Shaymin EX because he may feel that it's out of range from a KO here. It does, however, mean that he somehow has to move the Shaymin EX out of the active on his own turn, maybe with an attachment for turn. So it's a small play from Pram, but I do quite like it here.
I do like it. And of course, the Fighting Fury Bout on the Shaymin, you know, firstly, makes it incredibly difficult to KO. But secondly, it means that there's going to be no Floatstone Retreat here. So that Shaymin is going to be stuck in the active. Jacob doesn't play Escape Rope. He plays a single copy of Olympia, and that's his only switching card other than the Floatstones, which are out of play. He might have to just attach an energy to retreat, but then again, maybe Jacob's thinking, well, I don't really want more than three energy on an Yveltal at the moment. I don't want the big KO. I can't have the big KO. I'd rather chip away and get two hit KOs, and that means I can afford to put the energy on the Shaymin. Certainly, if he can get around this, it means that Michael's wasted a turn poking away a Shaymin, whereas Jacob then gets to get a hit on an Yveltal. And if Michael's hitting the Shaymin and Jacob is half knocking out an Yveltal, I've got to say that Jacob's getting a better part of that deal.
I do think that's right, but at the same time, it means that Pram is able to keep the other Yveltal EX on the bench. The damaged Yveltal is still a threat at this point. It has a lot of energy on it. It means that if Jacob is to come in, he finds a way to move his Shaymin EX some point this turn, that Pram is likely to survive an attack with the current active Pokemon. Otherwise, he's sort of feeding Jacob prizes, and that's something that you obviously don't want to do in the training card game. So really, this way, it's forcing more answers out of Jacob right now, and at the moment, he sort of needs to draw cards because it doesn't look like he has a means of moving this Shaymin EX here.
I was just looking at his hand as you were talking there, Joe, and you're right. I don't see any energy in there. I don't see the Olympia. Now, we do see a Max Elixir coming down here. He hits it. He gets another energy. That's wonderful. Energy, according to recent surveys, is good. But he still needs to get the Shaymin out of the active, and there is even, and it's a very small argument, but now there's one fewer energy in his deck by virtue of the Max Elixir, so his chances of hitting a basic energy with which to retreat the Shaymin off of this Sycamore will actually be a little bit smaller, and he's got two basic energy prized. So he needs to grab that energy, and if he doesn't grab it, that Max Elixir, it's a very subtle play, but there is a chance that that might have, you know, been the difference here. And annoyingly, he does have a Floatstone in hand, but of course, well, you need a special kind of ancient trait to attach. Oh, and he doesn't have it.
Ooh, this is a pretty big, the Professor Sycamore not getting Jacob exactly what he needed. So Pram, with his escape rope, he's actually bought himself a free two prizes, essentially, because Jacob's not been able to move it. So it's a big miss from Jacob, and it's got to be frustrating when you're already one game down.
Well, the question is, does he have access to a Shaymin? Now, I know he plays two. I don't think one's in the discard.
No,
oh, and he does it. He just has to pass. Pram's going to get two prizes. He's going to take a 5-1 prize lead here. And I don't think there's, in a matchup this similar, I don't think there's any way back. This isn't Greninja where you're dropping a whole bunch of damage using the abilities, doing a whole bunch of healing. Of course, it's possible to make the comeback. But at this stage, Michael is moving into a huge lead here.
So we do see the, he actually opted to go for the Evil Ball instead of attaching to the active and going for something like a Y-Cyclone. So Pram is forgetting the fact that the Fighting Fury Bolt potentially was on the Shaymin EX. So Jacob potentially bailed out for a turn here.
Jacob is, and that is a huge, huge break for Jacob. He has, oh, and he's got the
Enhanced Hammer.
Thank you, Joe. He's got the Enhanced Hammer. He gets rid of the double colorless energy. I was so excited I couldn't even remember what it was called.
And even more important, somewhat, is going to be the end here. He's going to be able to refresh his hand. If he finds himself a double colorless energy now, and maybe even something like, well, the Trubbishes we know are prized, but maybe some other non-EX that he can throw into the active, something that he, basically anything but the Yveltal EX is something that he wants to throw into the active if he's able to get the Sky Return here. It's a real missed opportunity from Pram because he could have put himself in, as you were saying, a very ascending position.
Although it looks like he's again missed the energy.
Oh,
that is absolutely heartbreaking.
You can see it on his face that he's just shaking his head, having to pass here.
Got the two Sycamores.
That is brutal.
Oh my goodness, and you see Pram doing some maths there. He might even be thinking about a Lysander KO on that Yveltal EX on the bench. If Pram takes two prizes this turn, it's just going to be so hard for Jacob to actually make a comeback. There's an Enhanced Hammer of Michael's own, and we see here he counts a one Yveltal and discards the energy from another. Yeah. I'm thinking he's thinking that he can get a KO due to the four energy, and this is what we've been saying a lot today, Joe. If you put energy on your Yveltal, you then almost help your opponent get the KO. So if you can KO one of them while hurting the other one, and it looks like he's just taken the shaming KO, and he's thinking, I can KO that four energy of Yveltal, and then I'm the European champion.
Absolutely. It's just an attachment away, I believe. So if Jacob does, it looks like he's forced into an evil ball situation, and it means that Michael's Yveltal EXs are safe from a one-hit KO, whereas Jacob's is much more vulnerable with currently no Fighting Fury belt. So very smart plays from Michael, showing exactly where to and how to play these enhanced hammers. We are going to see Jacob go for the max elixir here, maybe to change things. He does get himself an attachment, so that's already a very good start. He could have promoted the current active simply so that he could pay retreat and maybe get a little bit out of range from Michael's own Yveltal. So it's going to be interesting to see how he progresses his turn here.
And I've got to go back to that max elixir play. There were two supporters in a row, a Sycamore followed by an N, where he didn't hit the energy. And I'm not saying it was the reason, but maybe if he doesn't play that max elixir, maybe there's one more energy in his deck, maybe he draws it. We don't know. This is a randomized deck. We never know what they're going to hit. But Michael here, I mean, it's not... He's got to be on the verge of having enough energy to take the KO on the Yveltal here. Now, we're going to need 9 energy total with the Fighting Fury bout. We've got 6 on the bench. We've got 2 on the active. So that's only 6 total. 4 and 2, we got 6 energy. He'll need another 3 with the Fighting Fury bout to get the KO. But you know what? Pokemon Center Lady to heal 60 damage in the meantime. I don't think he's going to be too upset about that.
Yeah, I don't think he's too upset. That means why not just take the 2-hit KO? If I've healed almost, well, 2/3 of the damage that Jacob was allowed to put on there, it means that he can just go for the slower approach. He has plenty of Yveltal in the back ready to go. I really don't see many ways for Jacob to come back into this game now. As harsh as it sounds, he's got to find an alternate win condition outside of just taking the prizes here.
He has, and the problem is that Michael, he's in a brilliant position here. He can just... hit. Ah, do 110. Jacob's got to take 4 prizes just to draw level with Michael here. So Michael going, you know what, I'll take the 2-hit KO. Maybe I'll get a Lysander, maybe I won't. Who really cares? Because he's so far ahead on prizes, it's really up to Jacob to stop Pram winning here, because you know what? He's in such a good position that it really is going to take something monumental from Jacob to swing this game, and Michael can just sit there using Evil Ball turn after turn, and to be honest, if he just says Evil Ball a few more times, I'd be very surprised if Michael didn't win this game.
Absolutely. So Jacob is doing his best here. We do see the N, and let's see what he draws off of this. It could be pretty interesting. We do see the payment of retreat having to be done, of course, because that Yveltal EX is heavily damaged and can't take any more. So it looks like we are going to see, potentially there is a Frightknight Yveltal, which he could put down onto his bench that he could Y-Cyclone onto. Again, trying to sort of avoid the big one-hit KO that Pram might be able to dish out. So it's going to be interesting to see what he can come up with. Pram looks pretty relaxed. He only had that one card off the end, but just the pure board state means that he can be in a relaxed position right now.
He's got 2 Yveltal EX that have 2 energy on, which have enough energy then to use Evil Ball. He's got another on the bench, which has 1 energy, which will need just 1 further energy to use Evil Ball. He's got his Garbodor out. He's feeling very, very good about the situation. And when you're sitting in Michael's position, the end to one doesn't really matter because... well, what do you really need?
Yeah, absolutely. So Jacob he's trying to think whether it's worth going for the Evil Ball or the Y-Cyclone to try and protect himself. He's kind of thinking at this point, well, if he kind of has it, he has it. I got to take a gamble here. So he's going to try and put as much damage on as possible to Pram here. We do see Michael is going to start counting the damage. He does have the Lysander, and that is going to be everything.
Michael Pramawat is your European champion, ladies and gentlemen. He came over all the way from the USA. He fought through many, many rounds over 3 days of his Yveltal Garbodor deck, and he is the very first ever Pokemon trading card game European international champion.
Yeah, for one of the first times. Well, I'm not sure. I'm sure one of the... many times that he has not just made the final, but he's gone all the way. And that's got to be a good feeling right now. It's been bizarre. We've had so many Yveltal matches, so many mirror matches as well. And this one interacted completely different from any other. Simply, Michael was completely in control via both games.
He was, and just brilliant play from both players. I mean, commiserations to Jacob. He played well, he did everything he could, he made the right moves. He didn't have enough in either of those games. The first game, incredible bad luck. Second game, he just unfortunately never drew what he needed at the right time. And the crowd, we saw a big chant of USA going up a minute ago. A whole bunch of Americans have made the trip over to London for this tournament. And I think they're pretty happy about the fact that one of their brethren has taken home the title.
Absolutely. And you can see both Jay and Pram, they were both in great spirits. They've done so well, both of them, through all 3 days. A huge amount of championship points on the line, not least the prizes. So at such a high stakes game, it's great to see the sportsmanship showed by both players there.
And in a surprise to no one, Michael Pramrot will be attending the World Championships this year. Who could possibly have seen that coming?
And I'm sure Jay will as well. Both players demonstrated exactly what they were capable of throughout, again, the whole weekend. It was just a fantastic spectacle. Maybe the final almost undersold what plays they could have had, and it almost seemed like at times the game wasn't as exciting that we've seen through other games. But at the end of the day, Pokemon anything can happen.
Yes, anything can happen. And the problem is, you know, we saw Jacob in that last game. He didn't draw brilliantly. He didn't have all of the cards that he needed. However, in some games you can get away with that. But you cannot get away with that when you're playing somebody of Michael's caliber who can punish any small mistake, you know, if your deck isn't doing exactly what you want to do, Michael knows how to punish you. He's going to set up his board brilliantly. He's going to do everything he can. He's going to save the cards he needs for the right opportunity. He did there, and just a brilliant, brilliant win from Michael there.
Yeah, he left no stone unturned. There was no Lysander targets, no other. There was energy all around his board. There was plenty of options for him, so it always felt in his control. So that does sort of conclude this tournament. However, we do have plenty more going on throughout the year, and we're going to have a quick look at what regionals are going on in the rest of Europe and also a lot of the American tournaments. As you can see, starting very soon with the early December, we have San Jose, California. There's also Dallas, Texas. We have the Dutch Open. That's the special in the Netherlands starting in 2017. We also have Leipzig in Germany, as well as Athens, Georgia. Plenty of you to get on with just in the upcoming months, and there's even more excitement ahead for the rest of the year.
There is, and I'm personally quite a fan of Sweden. I went there earlier in the year. I thought Sweden was absolutely wonderful, so I'm certainly going to be looking to see if I can go over to that regional in the 18th, 19th of March in Sweden. So, there isn't a huge amount else for us to say here, Joe, except for congratulations to Michael Pramor and goodbye from the entire commentary team. It's been an absolute blast here today, and I think we're going to chuck it over to Ryan for the interview.
Hello, and as we get into the closing stages of this epic 3-day event here at the Pokémon European International Championships, I'd like to welcome our finalists from each division on the TCG side to the stage. So first and foremost, from the United States, can we get Reagan Retzloff from the Junior Division? Round of applause, please. There he goes, very happy there. And then the champion for that division, can we get Kaya Leiflinger from Germany? And for the senior division, can we get our finalist Jason Lai from Canada? And then the champion for that division, Tanner Hurley from the United States. Congratulations there. All right, moving on now for the Masters division. The runner-up, can I get Jacob Lesage from Canada? And our first ever Pokémon 2016 European International TCG Masters Division champion, can I get Michael Pramawat from United States? Now, come on, stand on my right here. We're going to ask you a couple of questions. So that was an epic game, very quick game one.
Yeah, he just didn't get what he needed, so I just knocked him out.
All right, I guess everything according to plan, I suppose. But I think the biggest talking point here is that you've actually managed to crack that second place curse and move into the driver's seat. You must be so elated about that. How do you feel?
Well, I haven't stopped smiling since I left the chair, so it's pretty good, yeah. Wow, I'm just kind of overwhelmed right now. Yeah.
Wow, amazing stuff. You performed phenomenally well throughout the whole tournament, and you've got the accolade to show that right now. You're the champion.
Yeah, it's super exciting. I've never actually won an international event, so, you know, this is a big first.
Did you know you were in with a shot? How did you feel coming into this?
When I got to the event, I wasn't sure. I mean, it's like, you know, you just have to be good and anyone can win. But like, as we got closer, I was like, oh my gosh, I could pull this off. So yeah, it crept up on me.
Wow, awesome, awesome stuff there. Well, amazingly done there. So I think that's a wrap. This is all our division champions for the event here today. Thank you so much for being here at the event. As you saw on the screen earlier, we have up and coming events, of course, San Jose Regionals in America. If you want to head out to that, if you're perhaps from America and it's nearby, you can do that. Then slightly more closer to home, in Europe, we've got DreamHack Leipzig, regional event there as well, on the 14th to 15th of January. So that's coming up very, very soon. San Jose, of course, is this month on the 17th and the 18th. And then, of course, there's social media activity for all of our Pokémon-related activity. So Twitter, for the UK area, it's Pokémon News UK. And then, of course, for France, it's Pokémon FR. For Germany, Pokémon DEU. For Italy, Pokémon IT. And for France, Pokémon FR. And then, of course, there's YouTube.com/Pokémon, Facebook.com/Pokémon, and of course Instagram.com/Pokémon. And hasn't it been an epic 3 days? Have you all had fun? Yeah? You've all had fun? Oh, that's great to hear. Awesome, awesome stuff. So we're going into the close now. So from myself, it's been a pleasure to be your host. Thank you so much for being a part of the event here live. And of course, for the people at home watching on the stream, without you lot, it would not be as amazing. Thank you for being so supportive and with us all the way through to the end here. It's been a pleasure to have you here. Thank you so much. So from me, myself, Ryan Hart, and the TCG streaming team, it's goodbye from all of us here, and see you next time.